In today's video, we're going to be setting up an Alexa in Home Assistant. I'll also be showing you how to integrate your speakers, and we're running through a couple of features like text-to-speech and media controls. Check it out. What's going on, guys? I hope you're all doing well. Okay, before we get started, there's a couple of things that I'm assuming that you've got or that you've done in order to actually follow along with this tutorial. So first of all, I'm going to be assuming that you've got an Amazon account with your devices linked to it, and that account is two-factor authenticated. If it's not, it will need to be in order to follow along, and there'll be a link in the description that you can go and follow in order to set two-factor authentication up for your account. Next, I'm going to be assuming that you've got the Home Assistant Community Store, or HACS, set up and installed. Now, this isn't a full requirement for this video, as you don't necessarily have to do these things. This is more for the extra parts, but I'm not covering the installation of HACS, so if you want to follow along with those bits, then you will need that. And the final one is that you're a Nabu Casa user making use of the Home Assistant Cloud. Now, you don't have to be a Nabu Casa user in order to actually set this all up, and you can do it by making use of free alternatives, but using Nabu Casa and the Home Assistant Cloud is by far the easiest way. As always, this video will be chaptered, so if there's a particular part that you care about, then you'll find the timestamp in the description below. Jumping straight in, we're here on our dashboard, and the first thing that we're going to need to do is to just enable the Echo service. So let's do that now. So from here, we're just going to go ahead and click Configuration. Then up at the top, you should see the Home Assistant Cloud, so go ahead and select that one. That's then going to take us into the Home Assistant Cloud page, and from here, you're going to just need to scroll down until you find the Echo card. And in this little card, you'll see a little toggle button, and you're just going to want to toggle that on. You'll notice that when you do that, it will tell you that the Echo is not yet activated. So what we'll need to do is just to set up the Home Assistant skill within the Echo app. So let's do that now. On our phones then, we're going to open the Echo app, and then in the bottom right corner, we're going to select More. We can then choose the fifth option down, which is Skills and Games. And from here, we're going to do a search for Home Assistant. So just select the magnifying glass in the top right corner, and then simply type Home Assistant. Home Assistant should then pop up, and we can just select it and then just hit enable to use. From here, you're going to need to enter the credentials for your Nabu Casa account. So go ahead and enter those and then hit sign in. Once you've done that, you should hopefully see the message saying your Home Assistant account has been successfully linked, and you can just go ahead and click close. Back in Home Assistant, if we refresh this page now, we should see that state change. And when that changes, you'll see a new toggle for enable state reporting, and I would recommend you keep that toggled on. We can now press this manage entities button, and it's going to show us all the different entities and devices that we can expose to our Amazon Echo. By default here, I can see that Home Assistant is currently exposing 18 different entities to the Amazon Echo. Now, it's done this by itself, I haven't told it to do it, but I might not necessarily want all of these to actually be exposed. So let's say, for example, I didn't want these bed lights to be exposed to the Echo. What you could do is just select this little green icon and just hit Don't Expose Entity. This is then going to remove that from the Amazon Echo, so it's no longer exposed and won't be accessible through the Echo. And the same applies, really, if you want to expose an entity to the Echo. So if we just scroll down a bit, we've got a list of all the entities that are currently not being exposed. So if I wanted to just expose one of these, I could just select that icon again, but this time just hit Expose. If you were wondering how all these different entities were exposed without me manually doing them, it's to do with the different managed domains. So if we click Manage Domains in the top right there, that's going to show us a list of all the different domains that are available within Home Assistant and that can be automatically exposed to the Echo. So by default, you can see that the fan, the light, the scene, the sensor, and switch are all exposed. And what this essentially means is that any new entity that you add to Home Assistant that falls into one of these different domains will just automatically add and sync to your Echo without you having to manually come and select it and then just choose Expose. So for example, if we added a new light to Home Assistant and this light domain was turned on, that light would just automatically add to the Echo, and then I could control that from my voice then or from the Echo app, all without having to do this manual process. And it's entirely up to you which domains you turn on and off. So for the purposes of this demo, I'm just going to toggle all of these off. In the background there, behind this menu, I can see that I've still got two entities exposed, and those two are the two that I manually exposed. So I can see that that office safe is a temperature sensor. So if I just hit reset entities here, what this will do is just reset all the entities in that domain based on whatever this toggle is. So if I hit that there, I can see that that's got rid of the one that I manually set. And if I do the same with the input button that I set, I can now see that I've got zero exposed. So just to recap there, this reset entities can be used as a quick way of toggling on or toggling off all the entities within a particular domain. So if I was to turn this light on here and hit reset entities, it would expose all of the lights that I have in Home Assistant to the Echo. And if I turned it off and hit reset entities, it would disable all the lights and not expose them. So that we've got some entities to play with, let's go ahead and expose those lights to the Echo. So we can just toggle that on and hit reset entities. When we do that, we'll see a pop-up on our device telling us that the Echo's found new devices. So in this case, I can see that I've got 6 new lights found. And that's pretty much the gist of sharing your entities from Home Assistant to your Echo. Okay, so we can now control our Home Assistant entities using our voice or using Echo routines, or even the Echo app if that's something that you wanted to do. But what about if we wanted to control the individual media players? So for example, if we wanted to play music or have the Echo say something, or even do things such as control the volume. To do all of those cool things, we're going to need to make use of an integration that's only available in HACS. And again, assuming that you've got this all set up and installed, we're going to open up HACS, and at the top, we're going to choose integrations. In the bottom right there, we're going to press the big blue button that says explore and download repositories. And from here, we can just do a search for our repository. So if we start typing
Alexa,
that should then just automatically populate in the list. So we can go ahead and select it and choose download this repository and then hit download again. If we just dismiss the new repositories here, that will just clear the list and only show us the repositories that we currently have installed. And I can see the Echo Media Player here, and it's telling us that it's pending a restart. So from here, if we just hit the back button in the top left, we'll see again it's telling us that it's pending that restart. And if we just hit this navigate button, that's going to jump us over to our server control. And from here, we can just hit that restart button. Once your Home Assistant comes back to life, we're going to add that new integration that we just added. So let's go ahead and click configuration. And then devices and services. We can then hit the blue add integration button in the bottom right corner and do a search for the Echo Media Player. And as you start typing that, again, that should populate in the list and we can just select it. If when you're searching for it, it's not appearing in the list, then more than likely it's a browser cache issue and all you'll need to do to get it to appear is just clear your cache. The simplest way of doing this is just by hitting the control key and hitting F5. That should just take a minute for it to run through the setup, and once that completes, it'll pop up a page asking to fill in all the configuration information. Go ahead and enter your email address and the password used for your Amazon account, and then you want to also make sure that your Amazon region is correct. So I'm based in the UK, so I just need to update mine from amazon.com to amazon.co.uk. Before we move any further, we're now just going to set up a built-in two-factor authentication app key for the Echo Media Player. And what this is going to allow us to do is just re-authenticate this media player with our Amazon account without having to constantly enter a one-time password. To do this, we're going to head over to Amazon and we're going to navigate to our account. And from here, we're just going to choose login and security. And from here, just next to the two-step verification, we're going to hit this edit button. You'll then see an option here for authenticator app and we're going to click add new app. We'll then be asked about adding a second two-step verification authenticator, but rather than scanning the QR code, we're going to select this can't scan the barcode option. That's then going to give us a key-based representation of that, so we're just going to highlight it and copy it to our clipboard. We can then head back into Home Assistant, and in the app key box, we're just going to paste the contents of our clipboard. We can then just scroll down and hit submit. You'll then hopefully get a confirmation, and in that confirmation, you'll have a one-time password code. So we just need to copy that to our clipboard. And back on our Amazon page, we're going to want to paste that code in and then hit verify and continue. We're now done with the Amazon page. And if we come back to Home Assistant, we just need to select this box for the app key confirm and then hit submit. When you hit that submit as part of the final confirmation, it should just ping you over to Amazon where you'll just need to sign in again just to confirm your credentials. So go ahead and enter your Amazon email address and password and then hit sign in. As you're now signing into Amazon from a different source and you've got two-step verification enabled, you will need to enter a one-time password using your authenticator app or whatever you usually use for your Amazon authentication, and that will be the code that we enter here. So this code is not that code that we just had a second ago, it's a new code from your authenticator. So get that code and then go ahead and hit sign in. Once you hit that sign in button, it should just take a second to load, and once it does, you should hopefully see this success message, and from within here, you'll be able to see all of your Echo devices that are connected to your Amazon account. At this point, if you wanted to, you could also assign each device to a set area by making use of the dropdowns. I'm not going to bother with that and I'm just going to scroll down and hit finish. Let's start off by having a look at one of the devices. So I'm just going to select the devices here. And from this list, I'm just going to choose one of my Echoes. So let's just go for Aurora's Echo. Then in here, I can see all the different controls that I have access to for Aurora's Echo. as well as the different sensors. So here I can see what the Echo is currently doing, and it's currently doing nothing, so it's just in standby mode. We've then also got the volume slider and also a do not disturb switch. The volume slider, as you guessed it, when you slide this up and down, it's going to toggle the volume of the Echo that you're targeting. And the do not disturb switch, when you turn this on, it's going to stop any incoming announcements or calls and just block them from actually playing out loud. You'll also notice these other controls and sensors that are currently set as unavailable or greyed out. And that's just because they're not currently accessible as the Echo is not using them. So if I was to set a timer or an alarm, they'd actually appear here. Here I've swapped over to my office Sonos and you can see that I've got some of those sensors set. So you can see I've got an alarm, I've got a reminder and also a timer. Just on the right there, you can see when those things are actually going to kick in. So these are the times for when those events are going to trigger. And if you wanted to, you could also write an automation and a script to actually act when these things do. You can also click on them to find out more information. So for example, I could select the reminder and I could go into the control and then I could view the attributes of that reminder. So I could actually find out what the actual reminder was. So if I just scroll down there on the bottom, you can see that reminder. And the same goes for the alarm. I could select it and go into the control and then into the attributes, then just scroll down. And I can actually find out what the time is for when that alarm's going to go off. So that particular alarm is going to go off at 4 p.m. If you happen to be playing any media on your Echo, you'll also see it appear in here. So you can see back on Aurora's Echo, we're currently playing some music. And if we select the control for that, we can actually see what media is playing. So I can see here what actual song's playing. I can see when it started playing. You also get access to the album art for that song, which is nice. You've then also got the normal controls, so you can pause it, you can go back, you can go forwards, and again, you've got that volume control. To wrap this up, we're going to cover one final feature, and it happens to be my favorite feature of this integration, and that's text-to-speech. So with text-to-speech, you can type some text, or you can have some pre-written text, and have Home Assistant pass that to the Echo, and then the Echo will play that and announce it on its speakers.
This is a TTS notification.
If you've been following along, you'll have seen that when we click the media controls, it's got this option here for text-to-speech, and when you type something in here and click play, you'd expect it to play on the Echo speakers, but it doesn't. What actually happens is the Echo announces that it's not able to make use of this, and you need to use the Notify service. So I'm going to show you now how you go about doing that. To show you how to make use of text-to-speech, I'm going to be making use of the developer tools just to give you a quick demo. So head into developer tools, and then up at the top, you're going to click services. Then the service that we're going to want to use is the Notify service. So under service, you're going to want to start typing Notify. And as you start typing that, it should start populating with a list of all the different Notify options that you have. So this is a brand new Home Assistant for me, and I've got lots of different Echoes, and you can see them all appearing in this list here. So if I wanted to, I could just select one of these, and I'm just going to find my Office Echo, and I'm going to make use of that. So I've got the Office Sonos there, and I'm just going to choose it. And as you can see here, this is going to send a notification message to the speaker that we chose. To send our notification message, we're going to need to fill in a couple of sections here. First of all, we're going to need to fill in the message. So the message is the body of the notification. And essentially what this means is whatever you type in this box is going to be what's said. So go ahead and write something in there. The next parameter is a title. But as this is going to be a text-to-speech notification, there's not really going to be a need for a title, so we can leave that one. Following that, we've got a target. Now for this example, we're only targeting the particular media player that we've chosen the service for. So in my case, it's going to be my Office Sonos, so we can skip target. And the final parameter then is data. So with data, we need to tell the notification what type of notification it is. So our type of notification is a text-to-speech notification. And I'm just going to fill that in here. So we need to write type, colon, TTS. And that's pretty much the foundations for a basic text-to-speech notification. So if we go ahead and click that call service button, we should hear whatever's written in that message body.
This is a great demo.
And yes, it was a great demo. So that's basically it. And if you wanted to take that and use it in an automation, it would be very easy to do. If you wanted to, you could just rewrite what you had there. Or if you wish to choose the go to YAML mode, that will give you the code representation of what that is, and you could just copy and paste that then into an automation. But as this is such a simple one, you could just easily type that out again. And as you can see from an automation perspective, it looks exactly the same. So with an automation, you'd set your trigger, and then in your action, you'd use the same thing. So you'd set the notification service, and then you'd also set the data, the type, and your message. And there we go, guys. That's been a look at how we set up
Alexa
and Home Assistant and how we make use of some of the features like text-to-speech and media controls. This video is the first part of a couple of videos that I'm going to be doing. So this one was mainly all about the setup and just a couple of little features. but in the next video, we'll be looking at sequences, routines, and how to do things like play music, sound effects, and much, much more. If you have enjoyed this video, then don't forget to drop it a like, and if you're not already, hit that subscribe button and ding-dong the notification bell. You'll then be alerted to any future videos that I do. And as always, a massive thank you to these awesome dudes. These awesome dudes are my Patreons. If you're interested in helping support my channel, which in turn allows me to create videos like this, then you'll find a link to my Patreon in the description below. So thank you for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one. Cheers.